have read 1,000 faces. I must have robbed them of their cause. Sick and thirst keeps it together. Soft white hum in the headphones. A podcast made sedated.
I've been wondering all week how you're going to pull that one off.
It's not. We keep picking. It's been tough lately.
The last two have been real. I thought this one was going to get you.
Yeah, even further back than that.
I really thought this one was going to get you, but you pull it off.
Not quite a sedated podcast, but it is the rare night record for us, and I don't know that I've had enough caffeine, so we'll say it works.
Definitely the end of a work day, energy waning a little bit, but it's all right. We have an energetic band to talk about.
And an energetic guest.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll get to him momentarily. This is Columbia House Party. I'm Blake Murphy. That's Jake Goldsbie.
What's up?
If you are one of our Patreon supporters, extra thank you. If you're not, patreon.com/Columbia House Party. You can join and get access to all sorts of bonus stuff like mailbag episodes, bonus episodes, access to the Discord, which we were just talking about before we came on air.
Always chatting. Always to do.
Talking music.
A lot of sports. Talking all things.
And if you are not a Patreon supporter, or even if you are and you want to support otherwise, rate, subscribe, all that good stuff. We appreciate it. Review. Get some good reviews in there.
Yeah. Give us 5 stars.
Yeah. even if you think this is a 3 or 4 star podcast,
just give us 5. That one extra one's not going to hurt you.
Look, we've talked a lot over the course of this podcast about how album ratings don't hold up super well at certain outlets when you go back and look at them 10, 20 years after. You know, maybe you want to give us a 5 because it'll look better for posterity down the line. You don't want to look like Pitchfork 20 years from now.
Doing your re-reviews.
Unbelievable. All right.
Originally, we gave Columbia House Party 1, but now full 5.
Please don't give us 1.
Huh? Yeah, don't give us 1. Give us 5.
Be so sad.
Just give us 5.
Did I ever talk about At the Drive-In? Jake, set us up.
They're one of those bands that I don't really remember how I came to them. It could have literally been like HMV bin hunting and just like, if you like this, you like this kind of thing. I generally don't remember. The album we're talking about today was not my first exposure to At the Drive-In, which we will talk about. I came to them after the Mars Volta existed. I had no idea they were the same guys. When I realized that later, it made a lot of sense, but it wasn't sort of on my radar. I wasn't like, oh, I like the Mars Volta. I'm going to...
Are you suggesting that you don't think At the Drive-In would have opened for Red Hot Chili Peppers?
I am not. On that note, in 2001, I went to a concert with my friend John, and we saw Red Hot Chili Peppers headline at the Arcana Center. The opening acts were Queens of the Stone Age on the Songs of the Deaf tour, and a band I'd never heard of called the Mars Volta. Mars Volta played about 25 minutes. It sounded like they played one song. I've looked it up. They played 4. I've looked it up on Setlist FM since. Queens of Stone Age were still in, Nick Oliveri was still in the band. It was just the 3 guys. It's a show that I would love to go back to, but not see the headliner and just see early Mars Volta, early Queens of the Stone Age.
Lucas Nogueira, if he's listening right now, is raging.
So mad.
At this Red Hot Chili Peppers slander.
But anyway.
Are we going to do, well, if Bebe ever comes back to Toronto, we're going to do a Keen episode.
Oh, buddy. Somewhere Only We Know. After that show, I got into the Mars Volta's first record, very heavy. Then when I learned that At the Drive-In were a band, B, the same guys, and way less prog, because you know how I feel about prog, I was like, okay, this is the Mars Volta, but a little harder, a little punkier. This is my kind of shit. And they seem like a good band for us to talk about on this show, because they have influenced and had their hands in so many aspects of emo and punk and hardcore and what is and is not emo, punk, and hardcore.
My favorite topic.
Today, we're going to talk about At the Drive-In's last full band record, their 2001 classic Relationship of Command.
The pins down as her shoes grip the dirt floor in the silhouette of dying.
Dancing on the corpse's ashes.
Yeah, they had plans for him, and they had spun the last of the pimps. Polyester satin nail jewelry lips, while the guillotine just laughed again.
Dancing on the corpse's ashes.
And the paramedics fell into the wound like a rehired scab at a bareheaded plant. An anesthetic penance beneath a hail of contraband.
Dancing on the corpse's ashes.
On my way,
And then I mentioned Lucas Nogueira and Lucas Nogueira's musical tastes with intent. Our guest today knows Lucas Nogueira's musical tastes better than anyone other than Lucas Nogueira, maybe. You go down the playlist, you've got Red Hot Chili Peppers, you've got Keane, you've got Charlie Chaplin's music, not his acting.
Fascinating man.
Our guest today is not Lucas Nogueira, it's James Herbert. James, thanks for coming on, man.
Thanks for mentioning my finest work of journalism.
It's great stuff.
Interviewing Bebe about music. I remember that day like very well because I had no idea what I was going to get out of that.
Raptors the day you told me that you spoke to him about it and he was listening to Keane, I was just like...
Wasn't there like a punk or pop punk band he was really into? I feel like I remember that. Or
there was a lot of just sort of just mainstream rock in all aspect. Like, I mean, I think Nickelback was in the headline.
I think that was it.
Because
that's what I'm thinking of.
But he absolutely mentioned some pop punk bands. He was just so earnest in his love for like radio rock of various like...
Look, there's a reason all that music is very popular.
For sure.
By the way, that article you would have been able to find on CBS Sports because that's where James works and writes and does excellent, excellent NBA coverage. You can find him on Twitter at @OutsideTheNBA. James, thanks so much, man.
It was nice to have you in town. Yes.
Yeah, nice to have you on the pod.
Nice to hop on that Queen streetcar again.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing like the TTC to make you realize why you left Toronto.
Nothing like coming from New York and getting back on the TTC.
I mean, we have problems with our public transit there, too.
Yeah. Did they shut the entire subway line down for weekends at a time?
There are lines that are down like every weekend consistently.
We also had that when I was visiting, I wasn't visiting you, but we were hanging out when I was in New York last week. We had some complications ourselves.
Well, you were running out of the station. And I had to get you to turn around and come back in. I think it worked out okay in the end.
Yeah. It was almost very like rom-com-y. Like, get the text, come back. But it was just to catch a train that the sign said it was out of service and then it came anyway.
Yeah, there was no rom. There was a little bit of calm.
Yes. Light calm. James and I actually have I don't want to say a rom-com-ish history, but it is the type of history you might see in a show or movie. I will share that with you. So James and I both went to Queen's University. We were in the same year. We both lived in Victoria Hall. We had many of the same friends. We played in the same intramural basketball league. We went to some of the same concerts. We did not once meet at Queen's and then met a couple years ago while both covering the Toronto Raptors in Toronto.
That's amazing.
It's possible that we met and then just like neither of us made any sort of lasting impression on the other. And then we connected years later and learned all these things anew.
But, yeah. I have friends like that too. Where, like, we lived in the same city in school, knew all the same people, and then
we were one floor apart.
That's wild.
And like one of our good friends, Josh, is like a good friend of both of us, and like has been since first year of university. And it's a little odd. And you would get me with, okay, you didn't meet in the same building, and you'd maybe even get me with like you didn't meet in intramural basketball because you're just like who pays that much attention to your opponents. But when we found out the amount of musical overlap we have, including like we were definitely at the same Billy Talent concert at what was then AJ's Hangar and is now the Frosh Alehouse.
Week, like my first week in Kingston. Yes,
my cousin took me to that show. It was the coolest I felt in my entire life to that point that I was like at a real bar watching Billy Talent.
If you only knew.
And I was at university. Yeah.
The one day you would have this podcast talking about bands that aren't Billy Talent yet.
We're going to talk about Billy Talent again later.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
A little Billy Talent.
Interesting.
Nugget for.
Way to build that in.
At the drive-in. So James and I don't have exact musical overlap. James, you're into a little more of the harder stuff than I am. When we knew you were coming into town, we had you throw us a couple options for potential episodes to do here. I'm curious why At the Drive-In, and I guess more to the point of the episode, why Relationship of Command over In Casino Out?
It's just one of my favorite records. And I love At the Drive-In. I got into them like right as they were breaking up and have seen them since on their reunion tour. I mean, I actually showed up to see them at Terminal 5 in New York and they canceled the show after the doors had opened.
Cool.
But then
a
few months later they came back, and then after all of these years I did finally see them, and that was wonderful. But I mean, as you mentioned, this album came out in like 2000, so I'm 14 years old at the time and my taste is not sophisticated whatsoever. I'm like mostly listening to like nu metal and some sort of harder rock bands and the like.
What is like your guiltiest nu metal love from that time? Not that I believe in guilty pleasures, which is something we've talked about here, but like the one that you're most like, I can't believe I listened to that.
I mean, a lot of it. I mean, when I was
I listened to a lot of Disturbed.
I saw Disturbed live and stuff. Ooh. I was fully into, I went to Ozfest. So I like just by going to that, you see like 25 new metal bands at that time.
Disturbed was the first ever band t-shirt that I got.
Really?
Yeah. I don't think I had a shirt. I had like a Taproot shirt.
There you go.
There were lots of like sort of middling new metal bands that I was into at the time. Yes, I liked Cold. I didn't have a shirt.
I liked Cold.
I never saw them.
Nor did I.
That probably would hold up better than most new metal. Like I could like sing properly.
That's true.
Right? But no, so I look back at what I was listening to and like at the drive-in was like nothing like that. But I remember when I first heard them, like the energy that was there, like that did kind of speak to me and I could at least like understand that. And it was loud and it was crazy. I had never heard anything quite like them. I wasn't like into what we would now call post-hardcore or whatever at the time. Like I kind of learned all of that stuff through at the drive-in and through bands like that. In knowing that I was going to be on this today, I kind of went back and I was trying to see if I could find the interview or the feature or whatever that first introduced me to them. And I think I did. I found a segment from 2000 when they were on the New Music on Much Music and they were interviewed by George Strombolopoulos and they showed clips from their show at the Cathedral, which I remember knowing that it had happened and it had happened like right before I found out that they existed.
Damn.
So
RIP at the Cathedral.
So you grew up downtown Toronto, right?
I grew up in Thornhill.
Oh, okay. Would you go to shows downtown like when you were in high school and stuff?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So
you could have conceivably been there had you found out about them a little earlier.
Yes. Okay. And there were a few bands. I mean, like Refused was like kind of the same way. There were a few bands like around that time where I just discovered them right after. Like I missed an opportunity to see them. So I got like into them really quickly. And then when Mars Volta and like Sparta formed, like I would just go see them. Mars Volta was like my preference of those two. But I mean, I would go back and listen to Relationship Command all the time. I mean,
you've seen Mars Volta live too?
A bunch, yeah. Actually, I wasn't at the Chili Peppers one, but I did see them open at the ACC for System of a Down, and they also played four songs.
Oh, yeah.
I just looked up the set list. It was four different songs, but it was four songs.
System of a Down, all right.
Yeah. But no, I saw Volta headline. Like, they played the Cool House a bunch of times or whatever. But I think it's a classic record, and Casino Out is great, and if you think that's better, I wouldn't really argue or anything like that. It's just like Relationship Command was what got me into the band. And then I went back and discovered like the rest of their catalog and the early EPs and all that. And like through all that, like Relationship Command was just always my favorite one and always the one that I associated with them. And like, to me, that is like the sort of defining statement of At the Drive-In. And like, that's what they sound like. And it does sound pretty different, even just in terms of like the production and the mixing compared to if you go back and listen to anything else that they ever recorded.
And I'm glad you mentioned that because I think a little later we're going to discuss At the Drive-In and their relationship to these different genres and definitions. Yes. And there's a contrast there to In Casino Out and how that was perceived or is perceived now 20 plus years later. Jake, why this album for you? I kind of gave you the screenshot of James's message and you were like right away, you were like At the Drive-In, let's do it.
Similar reasons, I think. We were sort of talking last week about Lil Peep and the idea of some of his songs. Like, if you had to give someone a representation of the artist, what would you give them? And for me, I completely agree. Relationship Command is what At the Drive-In sound like to me. I agree that you could also argue which album is better, but that's not really the point here. They're a band that I've always found really interesting. They're not a band that's ever been like my favorite. I was really heavy into them, but I would never have considered them one of my favorite bands. But I've always been very drawn to them and found them very interesting, particularly as they exist in sort of the genre debate. Because I remember when I was getting into them in high school, it was, you know, when I was getting into all this emo, pop punk, hardcore, whatever you want to call it. And everyone would say, you know, Relationship of Command is like this unique pillar of emo. And I've always found that very interesting because I don't consider them emo at all.
And I think that's probably because Relationship of Command is what they sound like to you. Whereas for me, In Casino Out is what they sound right. like to me. And that's like, oh yeah.
And like, I can.
They were kind of an emo band that went a little different rather than the opposite.
And what I find interesting about that is I agree. And I also see how emo bands who cite them as an influence, how they got there.
Also who they were influenced by. And it's
absolutely.
I mentioned this to James earlier today. I went back to Nothing Feels Good, which is one of my favorite books and everyone should check out. It's kind of the history of emo unofficially. And I knew that members of At the Drive-In were in there. And they don't actually talk about At the Drive-In at all. It's just the guys from At the Drive-In talking about all the bands they like Jawbreaker.
Right.
And things like that. We're going to talk about At the Drive-In and Relationship of Command after this.
At the Drive-In, formed in 1994 in El Paso, Texas, founded by Jim Ward on guitar and Cedric Bixler Zavala on vocals. They played their first show on October 14th, 1994, followed by a second show at a high school fair, which sounds right. They released the Hell Paso EP, which is a great name for an EP, in November of that year, followed by their first tour. They released their second EP, I'm going to get this pronunciation wrong because I do not speak Spanish, El Faro Vive Carejo, in June 1995. During their early tours, the band developed a large underground following by playing basements and small venues across the Western United States, and much of their success was due to word of mouth, and we'll get into sort of the nature of their live performances back in the day a little later on, and when we get into that, it will make a lot of sense how their success was sort of formed by people seeing them live and going, oh, holy shit. On one of these tours across the Western United States, they played a show in Los Angeles for 9 people. However, some of those 9 people worked for a record label called Flipside, who signed them to a record deal on the spot, which is what you want to do when you're playing live. They recorded their debut album for Flipside, Acrobatic Tenement, for $600 and followed that album up with a 100-day tour across the United States. They absolutely are a band that just never, and I think the Mars Volta were similar to this, they just never stopped playing live. Consistently on the road, even before you had to, when records sold.
Yeah, I should maybe tell one of my friends who's in a band that's like that, that all the bands who did that suffered some serious burnout.
Well, ska bands have to work harder.
That's
so
true. That's true.
Jim Ward, the founder and guitarist, would take a vacation from the band, not for the last time, after the release of the first album until the recording of the second album. He just wanted to take a year off and not be in a touring band for a while. The final, or I guess not technically final, but classic, At the Drive-In lineup would fall into place around this time with Jim Ward on guitar, Cedric Bixler Zavala on vocals, Tony Hajar on drums, Paul Hinoyos, I'm not, again, not sure I pronounce it, I'm sorry I'm pronouncing it wrong, on bass, and Omar Rodriguez Lopez, who was on bass and then moved to guitar, which is crazy to think. There was a time when Omar Rodriguez Lopez was not the lead guitar player in a band and was in fact on bass. They released the El Gran Orgo EP in 1997, and as they were preparing to record their next record, Flipside just stopped being a record label and said, we're not going to produce records anymore. According to the band, they then literally approached almost every indie label they could think of. And this led to sort of a tumultuous time in the band's history where they struggled to find a record label. And this was in the late 90s where you needed a record label to put out your record, especially for a band that was starting to gain a little momentum.
And this was pre kind of the boom of this little pocket, right?
Correct.
Like, had this been 3, 4, 5 years later, it might not have been nearly as difficult to get on with the label.
In like El Paso, Texas.
There was no scene. They had no money and they had like various drug related issues and stuff like that too. Like this was not
sounds like mid-2000s blogging.
And they were in a bunch of other bands at the same time. Like yeah. they were doing all this like sort of overlapping stuff. Like there was no sign they were going to be this.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like it'll be a common thread with these guys to have 100 million projects on the yes. go at one time. So as they're at this sort of, I guess, low point in their careers, desperate for our label, desperate for money, Bob and Michelle Becker of Fearless Records saw them open for a band called Supernova at a bar called Club Mesa and signed them to a deal, despite the fact that Fearless was more of a pop punk label. And it did give the band, you know, a little bit of pause there just because they weren't necessarily a pop punk band, but they needed a label, caught on the label, and they released their second album and their first release for Fearless. We've mentioned it before, and that record was In Casino Out.
Fuck!
The entire album of In Casino Out was recorded live off the floor with no overdubs.
That song, by the way, Alpha Centauri.
Great song.
Great song. The album was produced by Alex Newport, who said that he mixed the album half asleep for 21 straight hours because they sound like that and did not use any overdubs.
Yeah, they sound like Red Bull.
Yeah, which cool. Apparently we will talk about. Bixler Zavala told...
That's cryptic.
It's true. It'll come up.
All right.
Bixler Zavala told Punk News that the album was rushed and that they were able to execute maybe 30% of the ideas that were initially planned for this record because of a lack of time, which I think also speaks to sort of what we were talking about at the top here about In Casino Out versus Relationship of Command, where I feel like Relationship of Command is really where all of their ideas and, you know, where they were trying to go with this sound would sort of be realized. Like, I feel like it's a more, not fleshed out, but a more realized record.
A less urgent record?
Yeah. But it was recorded over a lot longer period of time, but it does sound like a record of a band that's like, we have a vision for what we want to sound like. And they finally were able to put everything they were trying to do into that record. Or maybe not, but that's how it sounds to me.
Relationship of Command just sounded like bigger and it sounded more realized and it was also like, it was sort of like a more professionalized deal at that point for them. But there was one interview I saw where I believe it was Omar that said, like, you can't even listen to that record though, because he doesn't like how it sounds. Cause I think it ended up being mixed in a way that was like, it's like a little too shiny for him. But I mean, to me, I never thought of it that way. I thought it sounded like just so full of life. Like it sounded like them. And that's part of why I always so desperately wanted to see them actually play these songs live.
I think it's funny too, that the idea of guys would go on to be in the Mars Volta thinking that a record sounds too shiny. Cause that's like the Mars Volta's whole thing.
Yeah.
Everything is just like produced within an inch of its life in that band. But In Casino Out was a hit in underground circles. Rolling Stone named it the 20th greatest emo album of all time.
They sure did.
The band would go on tour with Knapsack and the Murder City Devils, which sounds like a fucking awesome tour. They would also tour with the Get Up Kids and a little underground indie band you might have heard of called Rage Against the Machine, who they opened for at this time. Bixler Zavala said about sort of their odd pairings with at this time of like these underground hardcore-ish acts being paired with these big mainstream rock acts. He said, our friends, the Murder City Devils, played with Pearl Jam on tour. And these kids, all they see on TV is they see Pearl Jam and that's all they know. But Murder City Devils come to town. They're like, I didn't know this kind of music existed. And what is this scene you're talking about? And maybe some of these kids will get involved and will get better attendance at smaller shows. And you'll reactivate an interest in underground music instead of letting them just feed off the TV all the time and listen to boring music. Which, maybe an odd thing to say about guys that you're touring with or want to go on tour with, but he's not wrong. And it does speak to, I think, how a lot of us discovered music at this time, of just like seeing opening bands and being like, what was that?
Also, like, Ward came up as a huge emo guy and probably just had like a deep appreciation for the scene and wanted his scene to feel like that scene.
For
right?
sure.
Like, guy who came up as a huge Jawbreaker fan.
In El Paso, which, as James, you pointed out, had no scene to like create their own.
I'd imagine there was some sort of kind of like internal pull to be like, well, that's the music I liked and that's the scene that they had. And I would like to create some semblance of that scene because I didn't get the scene myself. That's probably over extrapolating thinking on their behalf, but like,
no, I think it's a fair way to read it.
I would have loved to see them open for Rage. Oh my God.
Yeah.
In like 1999. Yeah. After that tour with Rage, the band returned home and was ready to record their follow-up album, which was now becoming quite anticipated. They had gained a lot of sort of mainstream attention through opening for Rage and through their word of mouth sort of catching fire and their batshit live shows. So they began recording Relationship of Command with producer Ross Robinson. The record was recorded over a 7-week span. Omar Rodriguez Lopez told Alternative Press, on that record, Ross basically ran the show. I was very eager to be learning at that time. I always say I'm still learning, I'm still in training, but the root of my training was from producer Alex Newport, who came before Ross. Ross, at that time, had a reputation for being the wild guy who would throw things or drive you around doing things like method acting. But for whatever reason, he didn't really do that with me. I know he threw a trash can a couple times, and he took Paul and drove him in an SUV really fast through the hills in Malibu, where there was no barrier to get his adrenaline going, and then recorded him that way. But for me, it was a very different type of relationship. that makes a lot of sense for how this record sounds, but it's also fucking psychotic.
Well, they got off light compared to the new metal records that Ross Robinson was producing at the time with like Slipknot and Korn.
Oh, really?
Was he? Yeah, just like- I mean, like he was like making them cry and like just like, I mean, his base, like his style of producing back then was to like try to get you in like the headspace that corresponds with the song. So, like,
but he accidentally turned Slipknot into Stone Sour.
Yeah. But then Slipknot just came back.
Broke him down too far. Oh yeah, current
Slipknot is good.
Yeah.
But yeah, it makes. But for a record that's just like 90% of it is just breakneck pace.
Yeah.
Getting your adrenaline going by almost killing you in a car seems right. I mean, not right. Don't do it. But I get it. The band said that Robinson convinced them that he convinced the boys that he was the guy who could get every ounce of them onto tape. Which sort of sounds like what you're alluding to there.
Yeah.
They tease the album as being more experimental and, quote, electronic, or electronical, as they said. They told Punk News, what we mean is a little bit more electronical. Samplers, keyboards, blah, blah, blah. And we ended up writing our most rock record ever. And it wasn't because of the influence of anybody. It was just when we wrote rock songs. And we hardly ever turned on the sampler or the keyboard. It was like, wow, this works, this rock thing. But we incorporate a lot of our drum machine and dance stuff, our keyboard stuff, into our new record. But for the most part, I would have to say it's a rock record. Maybe LA did that. Maybe not. I haven't really been here that much.
He should change his mind more in the same quote.
Yeah, really?
I think they thought they were going to make a Mars Volta record, and they made the defining at the drive-in.
I think that's probably, and judging by what the first Mars Volta record sounds like, I think that's probably correct, but we'll get into that a little later. The first single from Relation of Command was a song that, if you are into this kind of music, you've definitely heard before. It's a song called One Arm Scissor.
Yes, this is the campaign slithered entrails in the cargo bay. A new turd is the vastness, hollow vacuum, choppy oxygen tanks. Hibernate, but have they kissed the ground? Pucker up and kiss the asphalt now. Tease this amputation, splintered larynx. Shit has access now.
That song became their first and only charting single, reaching number 26 on the Billboard Alternative Chart, and was their first song to get regular radio play.
Not to keep going back to Billy Talent, but do you think they ever listened to that song?
It almost sounds like one of their songs.
Yeah, Ben from Billy Talent posted on Facebook in 2011, actually, on the 10-year anniversary of this album. At the Drive-In had a huge impact on us as a band, and I still think Relationships of Command is one of my 10 favorite records. This song I always... and my warm-ups with, because if I can come close to hitting the high notes on Cedric, then I know I'm ready for the stage.
Huh. Also, I think, is it Try Honestly that sounds almost exactly like the beginning of that song? Yeah.
It's funny, good like stuff. Knowing like they actually, they played that song on like Letterman.
Yeah, and Conan. Like they did the whole tour.
They did
it.
The whole thing. And like, if I remember right, like Letterman like had no idea what he was watching. And like Cedric's jumping around and doing his like swinging the mic stand and everything that he like normally does. It's just he's doing that for like a studio audience of people just like sitting down and watching quietly.
Thank you, nice boys.
Like very weird that that became what it became. I love that it did because I don't know what exposure I would have or like a lot of people would have had to them if that song hadn't done what it had. But
it's crazy to even look now at like their Spotify plays and that song is just so significantly beyond anything else by them. And it's like, and I don't think I had really any concept of that song being that big.
No, I certainly didn't. Because again, like, I came to it after.
Yeah.
Like I came and I was like, oh, this is clearly the single, but like I had no idea it was actually like a, you know, quote unquote single.
Yeah.
As I alluded to a second ago, they told Channel V that a one-arm scissor is a drink that is a mixture of Red Bull and vodka. So next time you order a vodka Red Bull, you're ordering a one-arm scissor.
Damn, how did I never know that?
I found this researching for this, and I was like, I can't believe I've never. I assumed it's these guys. All their lyrics are fucking nonsense. Like,
all their song titles are nonsense.
Yeah, I assumed it was just something they came up with.
No, I mean, when we were talking about how we got into the band, I wasn't like, oh, their lyrics just were so meaningful to me. Like, right. No, I had no idea what the hell they were saying. Yeah. And like, the same was true with Mars Volta. Like, this is how they write.
Yeah. They also told Channel View, though, that the song is about their tours, told from the omniscient character they named the one-armed scissor, who sees their hardships they deal with on tour, and that sounds like something the Mars Volta came up with.
So the Red Bull and vodka is telling the story?
I guess.
I'm so confused.
Yeah. We're digging into Cedric Bixler Zavala lyrics. It's not going to be the first time.
It's a good thing you guys just kick ass. Because
one-armed scissor was named the 255th best song of the 2000s by Pitchfork because they ranked 500 fucking songs. It was also ranked as the number one single of that decade by Alternative Press, which makes sense.
By the way, I want to, the next time that they update like the top 500 songs of a decade or a time span or whatever, I want to be in there for the arguments between like number 314 and number 350.
We've talked this before in rankings. Like, you do 100 songs a year, which for me, I don't get because of that exact, like, how does you separate 98, 97? Not just you, but like anybody.
Yeah, I don't do 100.
Songs. Don't you?
I did 100 albums for decade ended.
That's what I meant. Sorry.
Yeah.
I have enough trouble doing like basketball players. Like that's without getting into like comparing genres and stuff. Like, oh my God.
Our emo is just going to.
Yeah. But the thing is I always frame my rankings as not the best. It's just, this is what I enjoyed the most.
Your that's favorites.
True. And then it's like, you can't really argue if I said, hey, I really enjoyed being sad for the first 15 albums of my list. You can't tell me I didn't. Can't argue with me about that.
BBC Music called the song one of the most invigorating rock songs released in the last 20 or 30 years. Let alone the past 10, which I think you could say about pretty much any At the Drive-In song, especially on this record, especially the first half of this record.
Yes.
It's definitely a record that comes out of the gate. NME placed it at number 113 on its list of the best 150 tracks the past 15 years. And it was also in Guitar Hero and Rock Band, which is probably a really good way to expose people who've never heard your band before to your band.
I think there are like 5 times where I've just left out the fact that a song or band was on Guitar Hero or Rock Band or whatever. I do not have fond thoughts about
I do think that should be a bonus episode though, because there is something interesting to say about bands like this who are on that, and people who would never hear this band in their life are all of a sudden playing along to it and singing.
Similar to our talks about like how the mid 2000s MVP baseball and Madden soundtracks were just like, and NHL soundtracks all kind of kicked ass.
Yeah, absolutely.
Any song that was like Tony Hawk or Guitar Hero, like to me, got a boost from that. I mean, I do have fond memories of playing Guitar Hero.
It wasn't your thing. I think the issue was that the friends that I had in high school who would play it, like they always wanted to play just the worst songs that were on Guitar Hero.
Oh, because you just only got like the classic rock.
I mean, those are just the memories I have of it, and then I did not like it very much and did not buy subsequent versions of it.
That's fair. The other fun thing that happened on this record that you might not think would have happened to this record, that is they had a guest performer on a couple songs.
All right.
Someone you might have heard of before, a man by the name of Iggy Pop. He ended up on the record thanks to Ross Robertson. Omar told the Associated Press that he'd been talking to Iggy because they were going to work together. I don't know if they ever did, but they'd sort of been chatting. So Ross had passed him our previous records and he liked them. So of course I brought up the idea, why not have him come on and do something on the album? He mentioned it to Iggy, who was completely open to it. He came into the studio for a whole day and sang on Rolodex Propaganda and did the ransom note on Enfilade.
Hello?
Hello, Mother Leopard. I have your cub. You must protect her. But that will be expensive. 10,000 kola nuts, wrapped in brown paper, midnight, behind the box. I'll be the hyena, you'll see.
I love that that's Iggy Pop. I remember when I listened to this record the first time, I was like, what the fuck am I listening to? Bixler Zavala told Punk News regarding this. He came because he likes Oh God. He's kind of into that stupid Nookie song by Limp Bizkit.
That's so great.
So he followed Ross going, I really like that Limp Bizkit stuff. Ross is like, dude, no, because Ross doesn't like that shit anymore now. He's totally embarrassed by it. And he's like, dude, no, you've got to get over that. If you want to work with me, look past all the stuff I've done in the past. Then Iggy called a couple times and Ross is like, well, why don't you go over to the studio and see how I work? And we were there and he was like, I'm working with a band that reminds me of you. And we were in the background going, what are you talking about? Shut up. And he was like, why don't you come and sing a song with them? And we're like, Ross, no. And he's like, okay, just like that. He'd never heard of us. So we sent him a CD. He liked it. His only comment was there was no lyrics on it. He was like, I like it, but I don't know what to do. I mean, I want to do something. And Ross was like, well, Cedric has it all mapped out for you. He's like, good. I don't like thinking. He hadn't showed up in a long time. We were thinking it's not going to happen. No big deal. And he showed up and we did it. It was fun. He was a totally nice guy. People think of Iggy Pop as this godlike figure. He was just this little man. He was really nice, tame, and we were always asking him, did he take off his shirt and cut himself? And he's like, no. But the way he carried himself on the microphones, he was cool to work with. A very, like, humble but not way to talk about working with Iggy Pop, I think.
I wonder about the kids that, like, discovered Iggy Pop through at the drive-in rather than the other way around. Like, because, like, those people totally have to exist.
For sure. I mean, like, I didn't know this was Iggy Pop on the record till way later.
No, me neither.
But then, like, you hear, you know, especially his actual, like, musical part on this record, you're like, this guy sounds fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Who is this?
Yeah.
Around this time in the band's recording and the band's life, interpersonal strife began to rear its head, not for the last time, specifically between Omar Rodriguez Lopez and Cedric Bixler Zavala, which is funny considering how much they work together, although who knows if they even like each other at this point. Omar said that it was always like that. You see, there's a thing people don't understand because we never really talked about our internal affairs. There wasn't the reality show approach to bands like there is now. It was like that from the beginning. It was always me and Cedric. We were in tons of bands before at the drive-in and continue to be in tons of bands after at the drive-in. It was always sort of us against particularly Jim Ward and his candy-coated way of doing things. For example, people always say we broke up out of nowhere and we imploded because of the popularity, and that's just something that always makes us laugh. We're all good friends now. We all talk now. I invited Tony and Jim and Paul down to my house in Mexico and had them over. I flew them down here. We're all good friends, and we still laugh about that rumor because the breakup had nothing to do with that. It was just that I felt it was our time. I felt the lifespan of the band was over, and I broke the band up. It was all personal affairs, which is interesting to me because they are sort of, there's a lot of bands like this that get, like, you know, Jawbreaker is one, which we've brought up before. Like, you hit the mainstream, you hit your big time, and you can't handle it.
We've also, though, talked about a bunch that, we've talked about a lot of bands that either, you know, did three albums or did a longer discography and it seemed like they worked in three album sets creatively. That came up with Radiohead, that came up with The Cure, it came up with Blink-182 a little bit. And I wonder if maybe like three albums is kind of the, on average, the like life cycle for maybe not a band, but for that like creative cycle for the band. And maybe instead of just trying to work through it and find the next one, they were just like, no, we'll just go do something else.
And I think in this band specifically, sounds like copious amounts of alcohol and drugs that were going around in this band didn't help. But also the fact they were, to sort of that quote from Omar there, there was kind of two bands in this one band. Like,
yeah,
Omar and Cedric's musical sensibilities did not gel with the rest of them, it sounds like. And then clearly didn't from where they went.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think from where they went, like that's where it kind of brings it all into focus, right? Like, I think you can hear about a band breaking up and read like, oh, they had musical differences, and people just say that and you're like, well, what actually happened? Like, you don't need to interview them. You can just listen to Sparta and listen to the Mars Volta, and you can completely understand what Jim wanted to do and then what Cedric and Omar wanted to do. And you can hear that tension on some of the songs on this last record, and you can just hear it, like the contrast afterward is like right there. And, when he said candy coated about Jim, like, I mean, you know, like, I mean, if you listen to Sparta, and I liked Sparta like back then, and I still like that first record, I think is good. And I like some of the songs, but it was like, it sounded a lot like At the Drive-In, but more straightforward rock. And like, that's just what very clearly, that's the part of At the Drive-In that Cedric and Omar were no longer interested in at that point.
Yeah. And I think it's interesting too, that A, there's like a full document of the band's musical differences now with these guys, because they did have that split. But it's also, I think, what makes Relationship Command so good.
Yeah.
Because it's the one that lets them have their like crazy batshit prog stuff mixed with this very mainstream sounding alternative rock sound. And that tension and interplay is what makes this an interesting, good record. Like, In Casino is great, but it's one thing. This record's like a billion things happening at once.
And that's why when they got back together and like they, like 6 days or something before they went out on tour, they're like, oh, by the way, Jim's not coming on the tour. And like, I was pissed.
Right.
But I was like, that, like, Jim is like that part of the band is like really important. And, you know, when I saw them, like, Keeley Davis, the guy who's in the band now, who was also weirdly in Sparta, like, he sounds a lot like Jim anyway, and he plays the songs really well. It didn't end up really mattering. But like, I was just kind of like, come on, guys. Like, the whole point is like, you three guys are like the three creative forces in this band. You all kind of hated each other, but you made something beautiful together. Like, I want to see all of you in the band, but like, that's just in the latest iteration, which I guess we'll get to in a bit, like more thoroughly. Like, that's just not what we have anymore.
And Jim Ward is the Ray Allen.
Yes.
The Celtics big
three. But like, kind of like, we will talk a little bit more about this, but like, the record they put out when they got back together just isn't as good. And it doesn't have that tension and interplay. And it's just kind of like a rock record.
Yeah. I mean, there are songs that I like, and it's not, I wouldn't say it's bad.
No.
But it's sort of them safe. Covering their younger selves.
Yeah. I think that's a good way to put it.
All right. We're going to dive into a little bit of those albums and what they did after, as well as their comeback album and what we think of Relationship of Command today after this.
Relationship of Command was finally released on September 12th, 2000. It was released to critical acclaim and is now seen as one of the most influential records of the decade. Kerrang! Ranked it as the 47th best album of the 21st century. Spin called it the 83rd best from 85 to 2005. It was 6th on Slate's 100 best albums of the decade list. It very briefly propelled the band into sort of mainstream, not stardom, but success. Got them critical and commercial success. The album peaked at number 116 on the Billboard 200 and number 1 on the Billboard Heat Seekers chart. As we sort of mentioned earlier, they appeared on Conan and Letterman. And around this time, because they were sort of getting more mainstream acceptance and appeal, their insane live shows started to become noticed. And you can kind of hear what they sounded like and did on this clip from a show from the Big Day Out Festival in 2001. I know this is not a visual medium, but if you can go on YouTube and find that video, just search for the song's Arc Arsenal from the Big Day Out Festival in 2001. It's fucking chaos. Like, it's just Cedric's throwing the mic stand around. Everyone's like, I don't know how any of them are playing the right notes on their instruments because they're moving so much.
Some of them aren't.
Yeah. How would you know? No one there in the pit is listening for the notes being accurate. They are picking up the energy.
To your point of the pit, at this very show that clip is from, after a couple of songs into their set, they left the stage after telling the audience to calm down and stop moshing and observe the safety rules. After the refusal of the crowd, Cedric Bixler-Zavala told them, "You're a robot, you're a sheep," and bleated at them several times before the band left the stage after performing only 3 songs. He said, "I think it's a very, very sad day when the only way you can express yourself is through slam dancing," which I'm not against that because I'm not a huge fan of like insane mosh pits, and what a band says they want their crowds to be is fine with me. Like, I don't have anything against it, but I do think this was very clearly a band that was like fraying and just pretty close to being done with these kind of outbursts. And there's like, this is not what we want to be a part of anymore, I think.
Yeah, the context there, like, they're playing Big Day Out with, again, like, this is the early 2000s. So the other bands on that bill were like new metal bands, and the fans that were there, like, weren't necessarily there to see like these songs. They were there to like hurt people.
And, right. This is the Woodstock 99
and, like,
era.
Freak out. And like, I think at the drive-in headlining shows were probably like nowhere near that. That's crazy. I'm sure it was crazy in like a fun way, but like the idea, I don't think he had any outbursts like that at their own shows. I think that was at that festival specifically because people were getting hurt. And like there were, I remember like quotes from like specifically Cedric, but maybe Omar too at the time, just kind of like being mad at just how like misogynistic the music like that was on the radio was at the time. And like their difficulty kind of playing with bands like that. And even a band like Rage, they opened with like, I don't think they had a good time on that tour. Like they were getting booed. They were playing to like mostly empty arenas. And it just, I don't think that actually went that well for them, even though like, from what I understand, like they were happy to be on that tour and they were happy to play with bigger bands. But I think they did, even if they're saying that they didn't break up because of the notoriety and because of the sort of newfound attention and expectation of them and all that stuff. Like, I do think they were not particularly comfortable being the sort of act that they had become.
Yeah,
and
I think that's fair.
The kind of shows they had to play.
And I think if there's a band that ever had to sort of navigate the dichotomy between their music and their fans and their message, it would be Rage Against the Machine. So I'm sure there was some common ground found there between them. So because of the aforementioned interpersonal struggles, the band went on hiatus in 2000 in March, just 1 month away from their headlining U.S. tour of Relationship of Command. They played their last show on February 21st, 2001. Rodriguez Lopez told NME, "After a nonstop six-year cycle of record, tour, we are going on indefinite hiatus. We need time to rest up and reevaluate just to be human beings again and decide when we feel like playing music again," which was kind of horseshit because Mars Volta started almost immediately. And I believe Sparta did too.
I think they both went right into doing what they were doing.
Because that Chili Peppers Mars Volta show was in 2001.
Yeah, I mean, it still drives me crazy. And like, and again, this is coming from someone who loves the Mars Volta, and I don't want to imagine a world where those records don't exist. I still hate that, like, these guys were, like, toiling for so long. They finally actually cross over. They're finally supporting themselves. They're playing bigger shows. They have an actual career. Like, and then just over. Like that quickly. It was like, it literally when I discovered them, they broke up right away. But like from their perspective, I mean, they came out of like this, like nothing El Paso, like non-scene to become a band that was like reviewed positively, like critically acclaimed and had an audience. And then it was just done.
Yeah. Bix Rizzavala took responsibility for the breakup, saying that "At the Drive-In was holding me back and I didn't want to be confined to punk and hardcore," to what we were sort of talking about earlier. The band couldn't agree on a musical direction. Omar and Cedric wanted the band to sound like Pink Floyd's The Piper at the Gates of Dawn, while the rest of the band wanted to go in a more alternative rock direction. Alternative Press actually asked Omar Rodriguez-Lopez what the album after Relationship Command would have sounded like. And he said, "It would have been a heartless piece of garbage." I mean, I can only assume because I wouldn't have been doing it for the right reasons. And I don't think that expression or art should come second to anything else. I think the only reason to play music is expression, getting out a thing you have inside that can't be conveyed through any language, whether it be English, Spanish, Japanese, or German. So I think when something isn't real, people will perceive it, even if they don't. I just think that we would have imploded. I would have been very unhappy. Cedric would have been very unhappy doing it just to do it. And then a true resentment and a true hatred for each other would have grown. That's what happens in normal human psychology. You start blaming each other. Even though I would have only blamed myself for not leaving, that would be the true blame. It would be easy for me to blame someone else and be like, oh, they're the reason this record sucks, when in actuality, I would have been the reason for not being honest. Which is a very honest answer.
Sure, if every quote from them didn't sound like a lyric from them.
Yeah, they do go on. They're the Kyrie of interviews in alternative rock.
Anyway, so they go Sparta, they go Mars Volta. What does that sound like relative to At the Drive-In?
So Mars Volta sounded like this on their first record. Clips out of the pink eyesight. I'm not the percent in fiction words. I need sanctuary in the pages of this book. Just in with all the other rats. No sign that my skin will need a grant. I am of pop punk shit. The vermin you need to
Mirror, mirror, mirror.
So despite all that, in 2012, the band reunited, performed at Coachella.
That was Inertiatic ESP,
yes,
by the way, by the Mars Volta.
Off their first record, Deloused in the Comatorium, which is pretty dope. The reunion shows were met with positive reviews. However, Omar Rigas Lopez received criticism from fans and observers from his evident lack of enthusiasm when playing on stage, which was initially attributed to the death of his mother. However, he then later said that he was no longer connected to At the Drive-In's music.
Just like he predicted many, many years before.
At the time, they ruled out the possibility of recording new material. And then following the breakup of the Mars Volta in 2013, Omar and Cedric stopped contact between themselves, stopped speaking, blamed each other for that band's breakup, although stated they were still happy with the At the Drive-In reunion. But they would reunite again in 2015, this time, as you said, James, without Jim Ward, replaced by his Sparta bandmate Keeley Davis. Cedric said about Jim Ward not coming back, his head wasn't there, his head wasn't trustworthy. Because of the way Omar and I exploded with the Mars Volta, I completely understand that. So, who knows with these guys?
Man.
Could just say, like, I don't like them, we don't get along, but...
Because of the way we exploded.
Yeah.
He's jealous of all the paper I stack.
He does say he's a beautiful human being and a beautiful artist. I just wish he would remember he's also an amazing guitar player.
Did you guys watch the 2012, when they played Coachella?
Yeah.
I remember streaming that really late at night Eastern time and just being like, okay, I love that I'm hearing these songs, but what is happening
here? I remember not buying, they played here. They played the Phoenix here that year and tickets were $45. And I decided not to go because I had seen that performance. And I was like, I don't know if I need to spend $50 on this show. Despite what they said before, they released the record Inter Alia in 2017 to middling reviews. They went back on hiatus in 2018 and have not been heard from since.
Probably going to stay on hiatus if I were to guess.
I would think so. I can't.
I will say the tour they did, they kicked ass on that tour.
The Inter Alia tour?
Yeah. And I think when I saw them, it was right before that album came out. So they only did maybe two of those songs rather than the full deal. And don't get me wrong, the older songs were what I wanted to hear. And that's what made the crowd go nuts. But they were tight. They were great. Cedric was incredible. And I just, it was not the same weird energy of the initial Coachella deal.
Yeah, there's a great video you can find on YouTube of them playing Arc Arsenal in Brazil on that tour in 2018.
Yeah.
And you can't hear the band. You can only hear the crowd singing along, and it's really cool.
That's awesome.
Anyway, what I kind of want to discuss for our banter segment of this show, kind of talked about it at the top a little bit, but how At the Drive-In have sort of been, I guess posthumously, for lack of a better term, considered major players in the emo development of the early 2000s. And I want to talk about whether we think they are.
I mean, I don't...
Not to be too gatekeepy about it.
But yeah, I don't love the genre splitting. When I first came across the Rolling Stone Top 40 Emo Albums of All Time, I was admittedly a little surprised to see In Casino out on there. It's not something that I immediately classify as emo. But as you dig in more and you read a book like Nothing Feels Good and you look at some of the bands that At the Drive-In were influenced by and that they since influenced, Jawbreaker, Fugazi, those are clear influences on them. And then you look at bands like Billy Talent that came from them, La Dispute, Fall of Troy, Finch, even Thrice a little bit. They're probably not in there, but if you were charting, if you expanded that emo tree we always reference kind of tongue in cheek to include genres around that, including pop punk and post hardcore and stuff, I think they influence enough across different areas that it's worth keeping them in the discussion. And then I think what's, even more interesting is if you trickle down the bands that they influenced and who those bands influenced, you can get as far as a band like the Marmosets, who are making music now and fucking rule, and it's hard to trace that directly, and they're probably not emo either, but there are enough around it. So it kind of reminds me of Drive Like Jehu, who they were not emo really, but they're discussed in all the who influenced emo and who started emo discussions and retrospectives and stuff like that. So, I also think the fact that
Cedric, I don't know if you, I think Cedric tweeted a while back, At the Drive-In would not exist if not for a Drive Like Jehu.
Yeah. I think that's an apt comparison.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think their influence is similar in that it's not direct, but they're an important part of the moment, if not sonically fit in that genre. And then to the extent that our emo would hate us for this, but if screamo, whatever you define that as, is, and I don't think that's this either really, but if you consider that a subgenre of emo, then they were a huge part of that becoming a mainstream moment, even for as a prelude to bands like Alexis on Fire. So I think they're just important across enough of the bands in that genre or adjacent to that genre that it's worth keeping them in the discussion, even if, you know, you don't fire up In Casino out and be like, oh yeah, this emo album.
Yeah. And I think as we get further and further and deeper into what these genres and sounds are and what they mean to, not mean like literally as genres, but to us and to music, especially like, I think the last 10 years or so, we've really seen a melding of like post-hardcore and emo specifically. And I think in that scene, as you said, like bands like La Dispute and, you know, Me Without You and whatever, like At The Drive-In is all over that stuff. Yeah.
And James, you might have more of an opinion on this because you do listen to a lot more of the harder stuff than I do. So I'm curious as to your take.
Well, I think both, I mean, if we're talking about emo and post-hardcore, like both of those terms are pretty squishy. Like, and people, you can get really nerdy about like how you want to define emo and the different kind of time periods of like what, like emotive hardcore was, and
it
then
comes up a lot on this like, podcast, and I roll my eyes at it a little bit because some people care a lot about drawing those lines, and I don't really. I just kind of like seeing how everyone touches each other.
Yeah, I think it's more of an interesting, useful discussion rather than defining and gatekeeping what it is.
But I think, and everybody knows that that's how emo, like the fact that you can call Dashboard Confessional, My Chemical Romance, and Rites of Spring the same genre, like does not make any sense. But like, there are different kind of other subgenres within that and whatever. But I think even within post-hardcore, I don't know, when I think of like that term, like I think of Glassjaw, which they put out a record in like a few months before Relationship of Command, and Ross Robinson produced it, and it's called Everything You Ever Want to Know About Silence. It is a fucking amazing record that I love that sounds literally nothing like Relationship of Command. And these are two bands that are often referred to as like some of the more important post-hardcore bands to ever exist. And I'm just like, with Glassjaw, I can kind of get down with like, that is the most sensible box to put them in. With At The Drive-In, like you can put them in that box fine, but I just don't know that they fit in any one box that neatly. And part of the issue with it is that they evolved. And so if, like, to Blake's point, if you want to say In Casino Out is an emo record, but Relationship of Command is not, that's fine. Like, you could also say like The Color and the Shape by Foo Fighters is an emo record if you want to. Like, it, that's
my question to that is, who wants to fit in a box?
Yeah. Everlong is the greatest emo song of all time.
There you go.
So. Not the greatest. It's up
there. At The Drive-In opened for them also.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that would have been a fun show at that time.
We had to do some ranking. James, do you want to hit us with your thoughts on rankings?
Top three. You don't have to rank the whole record.
No. Blake is specifically teeing me up to say that comparison to Thief of Joy and that we shouldn't be doing this at all. No. I think it's hard for me to just rank this whole thing. I would just say I think we can probably agree the first half kind of kicks the second's ass. But like, also, like, I'm not gonna sit here and say like that I don't like, I mean, shit, like Quarantine is an awesome song. Like, I think like Cosmonaut is an awesome song. Like, I it's just like, when I think of this record, I think of the first three tracks like as almost one thing. So like, I would almost just say like, that is how I like those first three is like, that's what I love about this
record. Now, that is fair. I will also point out that I believe both of you like Relationship of Command is your At The Drive-In record, as we discussed, whereas mine is In Casino Out. So I'm on the outs here, and I won't put my fingers on this too much. But James, we pick a song from each episode to go on the mixtape for the podcast. I think we have narrowed it down successfully to the first three songs on the album. If we have to pick a song that either we like the most or we think best represents the album for the mixtape, where are you leaning?
I might go Arc Arsenal.
I would too. I think it's, we kind of said how this album is what At The Drive-In sound like. That song to me is what At The Drive-In sound like.
I also think there's the interesting element of At The Drive-In are such a, you have to hear them live to really, really appreciate it. And that's such a killer live song.
It's insane. It's truly nuts.
So I'm cool with that.
The tension, like seeing them live, like before he comes in screaming, because like, you know, it's about to happen. Like that
the
is
drums are.
Yeah. Boom, it's boom. Oh my God.
Yeah. Arc Arsenal it is.
Cool.
For the mixtape. James Herbert, thank you so much for coming on, man.
That was good stuff.
Been my pleasure.
Did you have fun?
Absolutely.
Would you say it's the highlight of your time in Toronto?
Absolutely.
Ahead of your mom. Unbelievable.
Oh my God.
Columbia House Party. Tee them up. new tagline, Columbia House Party. You'll like it more than your mom.
get out of here.
Let's get out of here. Sorry, James.